Okay, so what we're going to do now is we'll try to accommodate the people from this room first, and then we'll bring in the overflow. I think there's 16 people. Sir, you can start. If you can keep your comments to 3 minutes, I'd appreciate it, and then we can get everybody's comments. Can I just make one other announcement about your testifying? I mean, there's no, I know people want to speak, but if someone's made a point, I think the point's probably been made, so if you want to keep, if you have new information you'd like to provide, I think that would be helpful to the committee. I've learned a lot over the last 3 days, and I think the whole committee has, and that's the reason for this for this hearing. So go ahead, sir. Introduce yourself for the record.
My name is Ray Whitledge. I'm from Duluth, Minnesota. I'm a 10-year active Army veteran with 2 combat tours in Iraq and Kosovo. I was a primary marksmanship instructor for Charlie Company 135 Armored Battalion in Baumholder, Germany, as well as a primary marksmanship instructor for 164 Armored Battalion in Fort Stewart, Georgia. I've supervised the training of hundreds of soldiers firing tens of thousands of rounds and a personally qualified expert on military handguns, rifles, machine guns, and tank weapons. I'm here today to address the issue of so-called high-capacity magazines. What I'm about to tell you may shock some of my pro-gun friends, but it is true that high-capacity magazines can increase the lethality of a weapon system. That is the very reason that the military uses them. Now, it would be very easy to put aside all critical thinking and end the discussion right there. Have a vote, pass the bill, and ban these indiscriminate killing machines. However, we don't ban cars that go faster than 55 miles an hour because we intrinsically know that there's more to it. So let me tell you the rest of the story. The increased lethality provided by high-capacity magazines comes from eliminating or postponing a 1/2-second magazine change during an intense, close-quarters firefight against a comparably armed opposing force. Typically, in the military, that would be an insurgent with an AK-47, for example. What I'm talking about is time and how it's relative to the situation. That half-second matters a whole lot when clearing a house in Iraq or defending your home from armed invaders, because the total time frame we're talking about is just a few seconds, 20 to 30 at the most. But mass shootings are measured in minutes, not seconds, unfortunately, and there is rarely a comparably armed opposing force. The Aurora, Colorado shootings lasted 7 to 10 minutes. The Sandy Hook shooting lasted 15 minutes. And the shootings at Virginia Tech lasted over 2 hours. In fact, Sandy Hook shooting is particularly important because Ms. Martens was incorrect. Adam Lanza only had 1 30-round magazine, according to the Connecticut State Patrol website. He reloaded that magazine several times by hand, sometimes only loading a few rounds at a time. He would continue to shoot and then reload a few more rounds. So how many lives would a half-second magazine change have saved when the shooter was taking several seconds at a time to reload a single magazine by hand? Quite simply, the answer is probably zero. A single, unopposed aggressor in a target-rich environment is going to continue shooting until he is stopped or until he runs out of ammo. The half second it takes to change a magazine, or the 45 seconds it takes to reload a single magazine over and over again, would not have made any difference in these tragedies. If you could step away from the emotion of the discussion for 1 second, you will see that when police are several minutes away, a 1/2-second magazine change still only takes 1/2 second. This legislation amounts to nothing more than a knee-jerk response to tragic events aimed at giving an emotionally distraught public a sacrificial lamb in the form of an inanimate object. In fact, Joe Biden himself was recently caught on camera saying that none of these laws are going to prevent mass shootings or save lives. Finally, Joe and I agree on something. It makes one wonder why just a few weeks ago he was stumping for gun control while using children as props. Could it be political showmanship? Could he be following the advice of Rahm Emanuel in not letting a good crisis go to waste? Joe understands that none of these laws are going to miraculously turn bad men into good men. These laws will only serve to turn good, law-abiding citizens like myself and the 2 million other Minnesotans who own firearms, most of them with magazines larger than 7 to 10 rounds, into felons. I urge you to look beyond the political showmanship, look beyond the emotional rants, and I urge you not to pass laws that will turn me into felons for no other reason than political gain. Thank you for your time.
Thank you for your testimony. No, 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 please. Please, if we can just, we'll get through the evening and everyone will get an opportunity if we can just keep it calm in here. Please introduce yourself for the record.
Thank you. My name is Jeffrey Aarons. I'm a police officer from the city of Sabika, Minnesota, but I'm here representing myself, not my department. I have about 15 years of experience with firearms. I've won awards in regional and national law enforcement shooting competitions. I shoot an average of 6,000 rounds of ammunition per year in dedicated law enforcement training. I hold a SWAT certification, advanced patrol rifle certification. I'm also a law enforcement use of force instructor. I have a great deal more training and experience than the vast majority of firearms owners. If anyone were able to make do with just 10 rounds in a magazine, it would be someone like me. But obviously, no one thinks it's a good idea to restrict the magazine capacity of law enforcement, as we are exempt from this bill. New York State recently passed a similar law, but in their haste, they forgot to exempt law enforcement from the ban. They are now rushing to amend the bill with an exception for police because, in the words of State Senator and former NYPD Captain Eric Adams, you can't give more ammo to the criminals. In this statement, he acknowledges what we all know to be true. The criminals will not adhere to the law. We must be appropriately equipped to counter the threat posed by these criminals, and a 10-round magazine is not sufficient to do so. As a police officer, it's my job to protect the citizens of my city from those who would do them harm. However, I know that when someone's life is endangered by the actions of another, despite my best efforts, I most often will not be there in time to help them. Many rural counties are undermanned and underfunded. At times, as few as 2 units are providing coverage for up to 1,000 square miles of patrol area. I actually had to dial 911 myself last year. I received a call from an angry man who said he was going to come to my home and assault me. I dialed 911 for help, and it took over an hour for a county unit to arrive. The angry man arrived in 30 minutes. This incident had a happy ending only because when he arrived, he faced an armed off-duty police officer, and his angry bravado quickly vanished. I'm sure everyone in this room would agree that when someone dials 911 for help, it is best for that help to arrive as soon as possible. When I am responding to a 911 call where someone's life is in danger, there is one person who will always be there before me, the citizen who is being victimized. I, like most officers, have never fired a round at another person in the course of my duties. If all goes well, I may never need to. But I do need to be properly equipped to deal with that situation. If I have a need for more than 10 rounds, then the citizens that I serve have that same need. The citizens of this state deserve, need, and further have a constitutional right to be properly equipped to protect themselves. Also, I'd like to quickly say the proponents of many of the bills we've heard this week have been very eager to display pictures of dead children. But they conveniently forget that the very arms and magazines that they vilify on December 14th were responsible for saving the lives of over 500 children at Sandy Hook. We are talking about tools. They are only given purpose by the persons who are holding them.
Thank you for your testimony. Yes, sir. Oh, I'm okay. Well, you can go after him.
Yeah.
Go ahead. Well, then we'll have you go next.
My name is Stephen Peterson. Thank you, Mr. Chairman and committee.
Welcome to the committee.
I spoke Tuesday night and I felt the need to come back. I have a federal firearms license, permit to carry, and I'm also an independent recruiter for the National Rifle Association, but I am not claiming to speak on their behalf. This is strictly my opinion. I see two major problems with any of these bills, and particularly the one with magazine capacity restriction. First of all, it constitutes government taking without compensation, and I truly believe, although I'm not an attorney, that it will never survive a court challenge, an expensive court challenge, and one that's going to embarrass Minnesota. And based on that alone, I would ask that the bill be withdrawn from further consideration. A lot of the things that I wanted to say tonight have already been said, but I'd like to tell you a short story. Several years ago when Cabela's opened their store in Owatonna, I drove down and I was lucky enough to meet General Chuck Yeager. Chuck Yeager told me that the best fighter pilots in World War II came off of farms because they understood firearms and basically had a head start. We are past World War II, we are past fighter planes to a large degree. However, given the nature of the world today, and we've got upcoming challenges coming through in the Middle East and probably North Korea, I do not want my sons and my grandsons and anyone else's to be at a disadvantage if they were called into the military either by draft or voluntarily. I want them to have a head start, understanding, and having a healthy respect for firearms to help keep them alive and for us to prevail in these challenges that we've got coming. And these bills will basically bring people into an anti-gun atmosphere, and I honestly believe, because of our national security reasons, that is not a healthy environment, and we are putting our children at risk if we do this. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. Sir?
Hello, Gwen. Hello again. My name is Eric McLeod.
Welcome to the committee.
I'm a criminal attorney in St. Paul. One of the questions that came up very early on in this discussion was, how can any responsible citizen justify the use of these high-capacity magazines? Well, I think just simply the fact that there are several people in this room, several law-abiding citizens, including Representative Cornish, that justify that use is an indication that it's the moral issue here is a little bit more complex than it would be on its face. Very simply put, under stress, accuracy goes down. Another argument that was presented was during the tragedies that reloading on the side of the criminal allowed for an interruption of the crime. That may be true. That same limitation would be put on a law-abiding citizen in a self-defense situation against an attacker who is similarly armed or a gang of attackers. So do we want to put that limitation on a law-abiding citizen? And what it boils down to is no one has talked here about limiting the capacity, the high-capacity magazines for law enforcement or the military or anybody else. I have 100% faith in the military to use high-capacity magazines, as well as the state, law enforcement. I have 100% faith in them. I also have 100% faith in my neighbors to use these high-capacity magazines in a responsible manner. Now, regarding the earlier bill, it was brought up that local oversight is better. Well, the local community at its most granular level is the citizen, him or herself, themselves. And I say that nothing is more local than the law-abiding citizen, and they are just as responsible and able to use these magazines as anyone. So, two more quick points and then I'll go. Professor Vogel, which by the way was one of my favorite professors at Hamline Law School, he brought up the point about comparing the rights of the Second Amendment to the First Amendment free speech. We have a gentleman's disagreement on that point. One of the things that the Supreme Court said about speech is that the only cure for bad speech is more speech. Now, I'm assuming that when the Supreme Court said that they were talking about more speech from responsible citizens. So I would assert that perhaps, even though it sounds counterintuitive, that the cure for bad guns is more guns, but this time in the hands of responsible, law-abiding citizens. And I'll end by saying this debate is not new. It's been going on for ages, even back in Shakespeare's time, when he said, "Whether 'tis nobler in the heart to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or to rise up and take arms against a sea of troubles, and by opposing them, end them." So it's basically a choice. Do you want to defend yourself, or do you not want to defend yourself in a situation? Well, I have 100% faith in my neighbors, my family, myself, and everyone to do that. Representative Cornish, if there was a situation. And I really don't see the need to have this law enacted. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. When you come up to speak, if you have your cell phones on, could you turn them off, because they interrupt with the speaker, the sound system. Welcome to the committee.
Hello. My name is Ross Rosenberg. I live in West Bloomington. I'd like to thank the chair for allowing time for many people to comment on these bills. In my business career, I served for 10 years on the board of the Minnesota Comprehensive Health Association, representing the health insurance industry. I learned through many interactions with legislative committees and the Department of Commerce how challenging it is for you to gather the facts necessary to make important decisions when considering legislation. I'd like to provide some information about how House File 242 would impact the practical shooting competition community in Minnesota. We compete under the sanctioning and rules of the United States Practical Shooting Association, which has more than 400 clubs across the country. USPSA is in turn part of the International Practical Shooting Confederation, which has affiliated clubs in 87 countries worldwide. We have 9 clubs in Minnesota that hold sanctioned matches monthly and weekly leagues. Hundreds of Minnesota residents attend these matches from all walks of life. We have men and women, juniors, every occupation, including many active duty and retired law enforcement officers and military. The pistols we use in competition range from out-of-the-box guns from companies like Smith & Wesson, Springfield, and Glock, to very expensive pistols that have been worked on by custom gunsmiths. The average shooter has spent from $1,000 for basic equipment to people like myself who have over $15,000 invested in their open division guns and magazines. House File 242, if enacted, would destroy our sport in Minnesota. It would do this because the magazines we use would become illegal to possess. These magazines have standard capacities of 13 to 17 rounds in our stock gun division to 28 rounds in the open division I shoot in. The cost of these magazines is significant. Mine costs between $175 and $225 each, and the average competitor needs 5 or more. Since most people do not have the ability to move their equipment out of state, and no magazine can be changed after manufacture to limit its capacity, our options under this law would be to either turn in our expensive equipment for destruction or become felons. Neither of those options is appealing to me, nor do they meet the criteria for common sense gun control as many Minnesotans understand it. Thank you very much for your consideration.
Thank you for your testimony. Welcome to the committee. If you can state your name for the record, please.
My name is Frank Skog. I am the section coordinator for the Minnesota chapter of the United States Practical Shooting Association. Thank you for the opportunity to speak. I shoot about 5,000 or 6,000 rounds of pistol ammunition a year, and I'm a concealed carry holder due for its second renewal here in a few months. I would like to speak in opposition to both HR 241 and 242 for two reasons. The first, as Ross has mentioned, is that they will completely eliminate practical shooting from the state. This represents a loss of wholesome recreation activities for many individuals, a loss of economic activity that generates tax revenue for the state from both local shooters and visitors who travel from other to shoot at our matches from other states. Our section championship last year had shooters from as far away as Arkansas. The second reason is one of basic fairness. Those two bills, if enacted, would create two classes of shooters. Two classes of citizens. First class citizens would enjoy the legal protection of modern semi-automatic weapons with normal capacity magazines. These first class citizens include those with great political power, such as those whose security is provided by law enforcement officers, such as the governor, and as we see in this room, by yourselves, by being protected by uniformed law enforcement officers. Also among this class are those citizens of great wealth that can afford to hire off-duty law enforcement officers for protection. And the last group of first-class citizens are the housemates or roommates of law enforcement officers. The rest of us will be second-class citizens and would have to make do with lesser capable firearms. This includes those at high risk of armed robbery and murder, such as those that handle large sums of cash, pharmacists that handle addictive drugs, gold and silver dealers, jewelers, furriers, art dealers, and the like. I'm retired Navy. I served in Vietnam. I've fired rifles, pistols, submachine guns, 30 caliber, 50 caliber, and 40 millimeter machine guns, 5-inch naval rifles, and torpedoes, and held a top secret clearance. Mr. Chairman, is there anyone who can answer the question or describe the legitimate reason why my beautiful bride should be protected by lesser capable firearms than those available to first-class citizens? Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony, sir. We have a lot of people wanting to speak, so again, if you could keep your comments to 3 minutes and maybe not repeat what's already been said, that would be appreciated.
Certainly. Thank you, Mr. Chair, representatives. My name is Tim Keller. I'm from Chaska, and I representing myself. I'd just like to bring up a couple points that haven't been mentioned. I know a lot of folks who argue in favor of more restrictions on firearms are fond of using the phrase, if it saves just one life. And I'd like to bring forth to you folks, what if it kills one person or causes one person to die? For instance, I have an article in front of me here, a woman who shot an intruder to her home 9 times in self-defense. If a law that were, for example, 7 rounds in a magazine, if it were to limit rounds to 7 in a magazine, this woman would not have been able to defend herself. The woman that Professor Olson mentioned earlier who emptied a revolver into an assailant missed once and fired all 6 rounds in the chamber of the firearm. Excuse me. I'd also like to bring to your attention the fact that there are a number of active shooter situations that where the attackers have used 10-round magazines or, in some cases, 15-round magazines, and they've simply changed them over and over. For example, Virginia Tech, the shooter, had a number of 10-round magazines. I believe the number was 13, and he just kept changing out the magazines. At Columbine, the shooters used a carbine with a dozen 10-round magazines, a handgun with a 52, 32, and 28-round magazine, and a pump-action shotgun and a break-action shotgun. These shooters would not be deterred by limits on magazine capacity. They have the time to reload. They have the luxury of reloading. They have the luxury of choosing their encounters. The armed citizens do not. We don't have that luxury. We don't have the ability to carry 15 magazines on our persons to defend ourselves. These shooters have the ability to take 15 magazines and carry them with them when they want to commit a slaughter like they do. So thank you for your time and your consideration.
Thank you for your testimony. Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record.
Thank you. My name is Chris Hochuk. I'm from Stillwater, Minnesota. I'm a husband, a father, and a proud gun owner. I'm not going to talk about 242. Professor Olson basically quoted my quote about the woman in Georgia who, you know, fired, you know, 6 times, hit the person 5, and he was able to leave the scene. So I'm going to talk about 241. This bill is a direct infringement on my Second Amendment right to keep and bear arms. Again, you will be limiting the choice of what type of firearm I will be able to have for self-defense. Adding more gun laws and bans on certain types of weapons isn't going to keep guns out of the hands of criminals. Criminals don't obey the laws. This ban will not prevent them from getting guns. The argument that I've heard over and over again is the weapons of war have no place on our streets, and even I believe a woman testified to that yesterday. Semi-automatic weapons are not weapons of war. I challenge any of you to tell me any army that uses semi-automatics for war. And I can attest to that, and that's what the woman's statement said. She said assault weapons are mainly used on the battlefield. That's not true. They are completely different guns with different internal parts and extremely different firing rates. They just look similar. We already have very strict laws in the books regarding fully automatic weapons, and for good reason. They are far more dangerous than semi-autos. And where was I? That is why the military uses fully automatic weapons, not semi-automatic weapons. Big difference. Acting and drafting legislation out of emotion, not intelligence, is not a responsible action for public legislation. your focus should be put on, be putting forward legislation that would get to the root cause of the problem. This legislation is like putting a Band-Aid on a severe internal infection. Sure, it might look good, might make a person feel good, but you still have the severe internal infection you haven't dealt with. The main portion of this bill that I find disturbing is that existing law-abiding gun owners that currently own these type of firearms listed in the legislation are being treated like criminals. This bill limits the types of weapons, like I said before, that they can use for self-defense, and they do use them for self-defense. And I'll give you an example. January 10th, 2013, at 2:30 p.m. just north of Houston, a 15-year-old boy was home with his 12-year-old sister. Two men were breaking into their home. He successfully defended himself and his sister with his father's AR-15. You don't see too many of these reports in the news because they choose not to report them. And they do happen more frequently than this. This bill would require law-abiding gun owners to register their firearms, comply with the yearly secure storage inspection for compliance by your local authority, pay a yearly registration fee, and what is that? Is that an NFA charge, $200? Really? And where was I? I'm getting kind of worked up, sorry. It won't take too much longer, Mr. Chair. And be restricted where you can possess and utilize the firearm. Those restrictions are at a duly licensed gun range and property you have complete control over. How do you define complete control? Does this mean you couldn't use the weapon to hunt on state land or a friend's land? Really? With these additional regulations that would be enforced upon law-abiding gun owners, it seems we are being treated like criminals for doing nothing wrong. I feel we are being put into the same category as sex offenders. They have to register with the authorities, don't they? And they have certain restrictions placed upon them. That might be a little harsh, but that's what I feel. It's really disturbing to me that the proponents of gun control measures seem to focus primarily on punishing law-abiding citizens with bans and restrictions and not focusing on the mental health issue and enforcement of current laws and keeping guns out of the hands of criminals. Lastly, I will say, the problem is not guns or the types of guns. The problem is why people are committing these horrific acts. Where are we headed as a society? And how society is being shaped is the topic. Society is shaped and developed by what we see, by what we hear, and what we speak. In other words, what we are putting in our minds and hearts. And it starts with the home.
Sir, you've taken over 4 minutes. Four and a half minutes.
I've got 10 seconds left. Starts with the home and starts with the parents. I'll read faster, sorry. It's appalling how the entertainment and music industry gets a pass under the First Amendment, but law-abiding gun owners and the Second Amendment get thrown under the bus. We need to get to the root of the problem. And I want to close with a quote. I think Mark Mattioli said it best. He's a parent of a Sandy Hook victim. It's a simple concept. We need civility across our nation. What we are seeing is a symptom of a bigger problem. This is a symptom. The problem is not gun laws. The problem is a lack of civility. I do apologize for taking too long. Thank you for your time.
Next, please. Please try to keep your comments to 3 minutes or we're going to be here all night.
Thank you. My testimony was intended to be directed at the author of these bills, but unfortunately that author is not here. The majority of anti-gun testimony today has quoted national statistics, but we are here today to talk about Minnesota.
Sir, I forgot to, can you introduce your name? Did you
Keith
give
Benning,
your name?
Willow River, Minnesota.
Okay, thank you.
The majority of anti-gun legislation today or testimony today has quoted national statistics, but we're here today to talk about Minnesota. The proposed legislation implies that banning legislatively named assault weapons and high-capacity magazines would save lives in Minnesota. That implication is false. If this committee has taken it upon itself to try and save lives in this state, then I challenge you to do it by banning alcohol. According to the CDC, FBI, and State of Minnesota Department of Public Safety, the average yearly number of alcohol-attributed deaths in Minnesota is 1,164. A yearly average of 55 homicides in Minnesota involve someone under the influence of alcohol. Most of these alcohol-related deaths are acceptable because they do not receive the same media attention. Last year in Minnesota, 3 people were killed with rifles and 3 with shotguns. In comparison, there were 111 people killed by drunk drivings. There were 4 times the number of murders committed in this state by cutting weapons than rifles and shotguns combined. Yet, there is no proposed legislation for assault knives, assault whiskey, or a limit on how many beers you can have in your home. Why are we discussing violating my Second Amendment rights when the numbers clearly show that falsely named assault weapons are not the problem? The legislation you propose in regards to magazine capacity also affects the safety of my wife, a law-abiding gun owner who has a concealed carry permit. Your legislation will not affect any of the criminals that committed 1,955 forcible rapes in Minnesota last year. Your legislation will not affect any of the criminals that committed 6,364 aggravated assaults last year. Your legislation will affect the ability of my wife, a law-abiding citizen of the state of Minnesota, to defend herself from those that wish to do her harm. A gun is a tool that puts my 100-pound wife on equal footing with a 250-pound rapist by removing a disparity of force and allowing the weak to protect themselves from the strong. The criminals will not limit what weapons or magazine size they use, yet we are here today to limit the rights of law-abiding citizens. The Supreme Court has stated that the elected officials may enact common-sense gun laws to protect communities, but your proposed gun and magazine ban are not based in common sense, nor are they based in fact. Instead, they are based on emotion. The Bill of Rights was drafted to spell out the immunities of individual citizens in the Second Amendment to guarantee the right of a well-regulated militia to protect those immunities. According to the United States versus Miller, the Supreme Court confirmed that the militia was a force that was physically capable of acting in concert for the common defense, and when called for service were expected to appear bearing arms supplied by themselves and of the kind in common use at the time. Semi-automatic magazine-fed rifles and handguns are the kind of weapons in common use at this time. The Second Amendment also exists to protect the Constitution and the Bill of Rights, the same Bill of Rights that is currently under attack in this country. The National Defense Authorization Act, which allows for the indefinite detention of American citizens, is a clear and frightening violation of the 4th, 5th, 6th, and 8th Amendments. 9 states have introduced bills aiming to adjust or repeal the detainment provisions of the 2012 NDAA. It's my understanding that Minnesota is not one of those states. What that tells me is that not only are you, by inaction, supporting the violations of our rights, but now you are also threatening to cripple our one defense against current and future constitutional rights violations.
Sir, if you can wrap up your 3.5 minutes.
5 to 10 seconds.
Okay.
I implore you to think long and hard about what you're about to do, as there are many of us that will not be forced to bow down and allow the tools of our freedom to be taken from us.
Thank you. Thank you for your testimony.
Good evening. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Welcome to the committee. Please introduce yourself.
Thank you. My name's Angela Sedlicek from Lakeville. I just have a few quick points that I just wanted to make. I would like to reiterate the point that crime begins before one shot is even fired. Crime begins in the heart of a person, not at the end of a barrel or in a bullet. Criminals, by definition, are lawbreakers. They don't abide by any laws. Whatever laws you put into place, they'll feel free to break. I believe that these gun control bills will motivate criminals, just as in the article that was published in the New York newspaper. Criminals had admitted that this would motivate them, knowing who has a gun, who doesn't have a gun, knowing what laws have been passed. Criminals will know that they have the upper hand, and I believe that these bills would motivate them to commit more crimes. And as a mother of 4 children, I'm a military wife, I'm a mother. Personally, I would love to have as many guns and as many rounds as I possibly could in my home to defend my family. I'm by myself a lot, and so I have to defend my own home. And I just want to illustrate one point. Why should the same evil people that have taken so many innocent lives also take away some of our freedom? We're giving the control to the criminals. We've allowed them, basically, to come into our country wherever they decide to commit their crimes and take the lives of innocent people. And passing these bills will also give them the power to take away some of our freedom. And I particularly have a big problem with the lack of the freedom to transfer any arms that we may have that we would love to pass on to our children. I think that that is completely unconstitutional and very disturbing. So I urge you to oppose all of these bills. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. Next.
Welcome to the committee. Please introduce yourself to the, for the record, please.
I'm Kurt Bolton. I'm a Vietnam veteran. I was in the United States Marine Corps. I worked on the Trans-Alaskan pipeline. Alaska produces 700 million barrels of oil per year. The biggest oil reserves in the North American continent are in Alaska. Not many people live in Alaska. Alaska is easy prey. An enemy could attack Alaska. Typically, a country that is first to attack has the upper hand. The enemy may kill every man, woman, and child in Alaska. From the enemy country's standpoint of view, an attack against Alaska will make sense. The enemy wants Alaska. Every man and woman in Alaska will have one choice: fight and win, save their own lives, and save their children's lives. Every man and woman in Alaska who knows better owns powerful rifles with magazines that hold a lot of shells. They may have to fight an invading country and win. Every man and woman in Alaska who knows better knows they may have to shoot out enemy tank periscope mirrors in front of the tank commander using powerful rifles with magnification and magazines that hold a lot of shells. They also know that they may have to shoot out periscope mirrors in front of the tank driver. Alaskans will have to fight and win. If an enemy country is first to attack, hundreds and hundreds of thousands of Americans would get killed getting an enemy in a foreign language out of Alaska. No restrictions on guns makes this country look like a stronger country, which could prevent an attack against the United States and save hundreds and hundreds of thousands of lives. An FBI person on national television show is saying Adolf Hitler had a high IQ, and look at what he did. If the military has rifles with magazines to hold a lot of shells, everyone else also has to have them. If the police force has rifles with magazines to hold a lot of shells, everyone else also has to have them. There are 300 million guns in this country. The National Rifle Association has firearm safety lectures prepared. There has to be one firearm safety lecture in every school, college, and trade school every year. Children 18 and younger are looking at violent video games. All states have laws against anyone who is a murder instigator. Certified criminal defense specialist lawyers could start a murder instigator lawsuit against video game companies who are murder instigators. At the same time, certified real estate specialist lawyers could tie up video game company real estate.
Sir, can you wrap up your testimony, please? You're over 3 minutes.
Together, the above specialist lawyers could win a jury trial lawsuit against video game companies for making violent video games for children 18 years and younger to look at. The video game companies are murder instigators. There was no problem with children and young people back when there was no such thing as video games. I want to remind you that no restrictions on guns makes this country look like a stronger country, which could prevent an attack against the United States and save hundreds and hundreds of thousands of lives.
Thank you for your testimony.
Thank you, Chairman, and members of the committee.
Welcome.
Appreciate you staying late these last few nights. My name is Drew Haggard. I'm from rural Carlton County. I am a 16-year veteran of the Armed Forces, the Army, with 3 combat tours and getting ready to go do my 4th. I'm also a 19-year veteran of the Department of Corrections. The reason I choose to carry a gun, I have a permit to carry, and keep one in my home for self-protection and the protection of my family is because the deputy sitting behind me won't fit in my pocket, and quite frankly, I think we'd both feel a little bit awkward if he was standing by my bed every night. Several people have referred to the
what is referred to as the high capacity is standard capacity, and I'm wondering why I would have a, what I will call diminished capacity magazine to defend against a high capacity. I'm not going to go into a lot of details that I had prepared, but what I do or what I can offer is my experience from the Department of Corrections and working with criminals for 19 years. And looking through their records, I see that a lot of them are picked up on charges 5, 6, 8 years ago, 2 years ago, whatever, and they're picked up with a bag of dope, and they're picked up with a gun in their pocket, and they're charged with and convicted of the dope charge. We need to start enforcing the gun laws that we do have and enforcing the 60-month sentence that would have come with that gun in their pocket, but they're pled down. Perhaps in the interest of public safety, we could maybe suggest a bill that mandates that those gun charges cannot be dropped. I am seeing a lot more felony possession of a firearm with a 60-month charge coming through the prison system, and a lot of those are first-time charges for the state of Minnesota, meaning these people were charged and convicted of a felony in some other state, and now they're in our state and they're carrying a firearm. We need to keep putting those people away and putting them away the first time. I'm a lifelong Democrat. I've voted Democrat, which probably doesn't make me very popular. But here's the what's it mean to me for this committee, many members of this committee. I have voted Democrat for 20 years, and a lot of my friends have voted Democrat for 20 years. I haven't been a member of the NRA for over 20 years. I was a member briefly. Last week, I signed up for the NRA. And the people that authored these bills, their names are not going to be forgotten, and the votes that are taken in committee and on the floor are not going to be forgotten by the people in this room and the citizens of this state. We will remember. That's all I got.
Thank you for your testimony.
There we go. Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Clay Lampkin. I'm from Plymouth, Minnesota. And I think it's very important for me first to tell everybody here, I'm not a member of the NRA. I'm not in any particular group. I don't consider myself a Democrat. I don't consider myself a Republican. And I'm not a hunter. I'm not a survivalist. I'm not a gun nut by any means. I'm actually somebody who's kind of new to the whole crowd and to the whole argument. I picked up my first .22 rifle about 2 years ago. And so much of this, though, was very prevalent to me as a new gun owner because I had a lot of misunderstandings about firearms and things in my past. Through experience with friends that are intelligent and are safe and are careful and that are law-abiding gun owners, I've come to have a very healthy respect for guns and the possibilities of them. Now, to be perfectly honest, I have no expectation that the government is ever going to try to be tyrannical and come down and we need to fight against them. I have no expectation that my door tomorrow is going to get kicked open by North Koreans and be invaded. But I do enjoy firearms as a sport, all right? I have a couple .22 rifles that have 15-round magazines, and as per the HF number 241 and 242, I'm violating a couple different laws by having these .22, obviously very underpowered guns, and that's my biggest concern. I've never been to the state capitol to fight anything before in my past, but this is something that really, really spoke and resonated with me. And as representatives, I really appreciate you guys taking the time to listen to what we have to say and obviously bring forth what we want as protection, you know, as a whole. Now, the biggest things that I do want to say, though, is that I do think that there can be changes. There are certain things. You know, we talk a lot about the loopholes in the gun laws and things like that. I understand that. As a, you know, law-abiding citizen, I don't want to sell a gun to a felon or to a criminal. So I can understand some of the things that we want to do. But what we got to be careful about is the laws that we pass, that they make sense, that they're going to have an impact, and that they're not going to impact negatively people like myself, law-abiding gun owners, and that now I am being, you know, financially taxed every year to prove that I'm still a law-abiding gun owner despite the fact that I'm an upstanding citizen. So in the end, thank you guys very much. I appreciate your time. Thanks for staying so late. And, you know, I want sanity to rule here and not fear. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your testimony. Please introduce yourself.
Mr. Chair, representatives and committee members, my name is John Humanansky. I really appreciate the opportunity to come and speak to you tonight about this important issue. I believe that you're all sincerely interested in making our communities, cities, counties, and schools safer places to live. But in reviewing all of these proposals that have been discussed this week, the target seems to be the law-abiding citizen. So what I've done is I hope you'll give me a little latitude here. I've taken an absurdity out of some of the sections in one of the bills I think you'll recognize, and to make a more absurd proposal for legislation that would probably actually make our communities safer. So here we go. Many of our metropolitan cities and maybe some of the smaller cities have gangs. The police in these cities know who the gangs are and many of the members. So I'm proposing in this mock legislation that we change the target to assault weapons in high magazine capacity to gangs and gang members. So here are some of the provisions. The gangs and all gang members must be registered. Limit gang membership to a maximum capacity of 7 members. Now, if House File 242 is adopted, I'd be willing to change that to 10. Weapons owned by the gang members must be secured in a safe, and the registration must be renewed annually. Gang members agree to permit a government agency to inspect their homes on an annual basis to make sure that the guns and weapons are stored safely. The annual inspection will be conducted by local law enforcement. Membership in the gang cannot be transferred or conferred to another person. Gang members lost through normal attrition, that would be resignations, shootouts with police, shootouts with other gang members, accidental death, or other methods of attrition, they cannot be replaced. Gang activities will not be permitted in gang-free zones. So I think there are a lot of things that you can address, and I think I'm not against more thorough background checks. I think gun ownership is a tremendous responsibility, so I think might be an education component. This was demonstrated tragically back in December when there were two young children that were killed because their parents, one had a loaded firearm under a pillow and another one had to climb up a dresser. I believe that resulted in two fatalities. So there are a lot of law-abiding, stupid gun owners that we have to get to. But attacking law-abiding citizens that most of the legislation we've been talking about this week is going to do nothing. People before me have described the number and volume of high-capacity magazines and weapons that are out there. You're going to create a black market. How did prohibition work? Don't we have laws against drugs, cocaine, heroin, marijuana? How's that working out? Yeah. So there is a tremendous black market here, and you're going to make criminals out of law-abiding people that have a legitimate need for whatever, self-defense, hunting, target shooting, competitive shooting, or self-defense. So I hope you're going to consider some of these ideas, and I hope you understand the absurdity of what I just proposed here, and think about what you're proposing in this case. You probably already know it was House File 241. Thank you. If you have any questions, I'd be glad to take them.
Representative Lesh.
Just as a point, sir, we have gang registration of sorts in this state. We have a gang checklist the police check off. We also passed a law about 5 years ago of gang-free zones where you can't associate with other gang members under the civil system. So appreciate it, but it's actually not.
Well, how are most of these school shootings?
Mr. Chair,
sorry.
This Representative was not really Lesh. A question, sir. It was just a comment.
Okay.
Saying your idea was not all that absurd because the legislature carried it out.
Thank you.
Most of these school shootings, I believe, have occurred in gun-free zones.
Thank you for your testimony.
You thanks.
Welcome to the committee. Could you state your name for the record, please?
Rod Garberson from Coon Rapids. Mr. Chair, members of the committee, thanks and good evening. That's a hard act to follow. A lot of good things have been said here tonight. I'm not going to waste a lot of time, but I want to address a myth that's been floated. There's nobody in here in this room besides Chris Rager from the NRA that's being paid I think you see the enthusiasm of the grassroots. This is a call of duty for patriots to oppose this effort of these gun restrictions. Furthermore, we're glad Mr. Rager is here to support us. For myself and the citizens here who are members of the NRA, Mr. Rager's presence is exactly why we enthusiastically, in any romantic sense of American patriotism, are members of the NRA and every other civil rights organization whose purpose is to protect our right. Thank you. Mr. Chair, members of the committee, we have a paradigm disparity. The national discussion we're having about gun violence is, in its essence, only simply violence. We can all agree that firearms are an instrument of force, but that's where our agreement breaks down into separate paradigms of what the purpose of firearms is. We supporters of the right to keep and bear arms see firearms in a single paradigm as defensive instruments to deter crime and to protect life, liberty, and property. A good instrument. You on the other side see them primarily only as instruments for criminals, a bad instrument. Secondly, you see them as tools for taking game in the field for sport, a privilege. And thirdly, you see firearms as instruments for government to render the citizenry submissive, a necessity. We heard testimony on Tuesday from a young man whose brother, his hero, shot a convenience store clerk. Aside from the peculiarity of this man feeling sorry for himself and his brother with his life sentence, expressing no pity for the clerk who was shot, we can consider that anecdote substituting a different instrument of force, a baseball bat, a knife, a brick, or more terrifying yet, all five of those thugs beating that person with their fists and feet to a bloody pulp. The gun was only an instrument. It could have been any other instrument, and that substitute instrument would have made the assault and the resulting end much more horrific. We also heard testimony from a woman whose depressed, anguished daughter committed suicide in a hotel room. I feel sorry for that mother. It crushes me. But again, in this anecdote, the gun was only an instrument. In a conversation last summer, my neighbor, a Coon Rapids firefighter, told me that the most common cause of unnatural death in Coon Rapids was suicide. As an on-guard self-defense civil rights activist, I assume that self-inflicted gunshot would be the most common method. So I asked him, what is the most common method in your experience? He replied, hanging. They'll use anything, extension cords, fishing lines, speaker wire, rope, you name it. Again, the firearm is only an instrument. I'm going to skip some of this. A lot of this has been touched on. I want to share an anecdote with you, all of you. Last summer, my family and I were in the Black Hills when that Aurora, Colorado shooting happened. I caught it down there at the Continental Breakfast. I came up, turned the TV on. My wife was watching. My 12-year-old son started to watch the TV. And he said, is this real? And I said, yeah, it's real. And he took in another minute or two of the news. And he looked at me and he said, why didn't anybody shoot back? And I said, there's a sign on the door that says, guns are not allowed. My kids, I'm a concealed carry permit holder. My kids both know, I have two, boy 12, daughter 9, they both know that they're safe. My daughter, when she was going to school after the Connecticut shooting, she said, Dad, I wish you were there. So with that, I'm going to close. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your testimony. Welcome to the committee. Could you state your name for the record, please?
My name is Sherry Green. I'm from St. Paul Park, Minnesota. And I thank the chairman and the committee for the opportunity to speak here. I'm going to tell you a little bit about my background simply because I think it relates to some of the perceptions we've heard discussed here. I just recently retired after 21 years in the position of community education, school age care director for a local metropolitan school district that serves the families of 7 districts. The chief charge of my employment was to ensure the physical and emotional safety of the 500 children that I had in school, 7 schools, before and after school each day. In the course of my employment, I was entrusted with several million dollars worth of federal and Minnesota state grants to develop programming that provided the needs of the safety of children before and after schools to ensure that we met the needs of at-risk youth and children with special needs, both physical and emotional. I give you these not to talk about me personally, but because I have heard that no rational-minded person would make the decision to use a gun with a magazine with over 10 rounds in the magazine. I hope that that somewhat shows you that I consider myself a rational-minded person and that the state of Minnesota and the federal government at some points have considered me such. Also, the parents who entrusted the care of their children to my program and the school district, which was kind enough to let me perform that job for 21 years. I do use a target pistol that has 12 rounds in the magazine. I've never considered myself a threat to anybody's personal safety. I also use a gun with over 15 rounds in the magazine because I am a property owner of 80 acres of rural land where I share that area with bear, cougar, and meth labs. I would hate to surprise any of those entities and not have the capacity to defend myself. I don't know if anybody who has heard of a mama bear protecting her cubs, but I can assure you that I want to make sure I have enough ammunition to deal with them or a meth operator. Thank you for your time.
Thank you for your testimony.
My name is Anthony Hulsebus. I'm with the Concerned Citizens Against Violence. I'm just surprised, as the state of Minnesota is a leader in health, that nobody's brought up more of the mental health issues. So I'm going to touch on that just a little bit tonight. One of the common links, in fact, the most common link that every mass shooter has, is that they have been users of SSRI drugs or selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors. Adam Lanza was just prescribed FANAP, another psychotropic drug. Several neighbors confirmed he was on medication for his mental state. Eric Harris and Dylan Klebold both were using Zoloft and Luvox, which was in the Columbine shooting. The worst school shooting in U.S. history was done by a young man who had been on SSRI drugs, but his current medical file is not accessible. Who is keeping his file closed and why? Steve Kamarczyk, 27, shot and killed five people and wounded 21 others before killing himself at Northern Illinois University. According to his girlfriend, he had recently been taking Prozac, Xanax, and Ambien. Toxicology reports showed that he still had a trace of Xanax in his system. Jeff Weiss, here in Red Lake, Minnesota, age 16, had been prescribed 60 milligrams a day of Prozac, three times the average starting dose for adults. When he shot his grandfather, his grandfather's girlfriend, and many fellow students at Red Lake, Minnesota, he then shot himself, 10 dead and 12 wounded. I have a list of 4,800 cases of murder and suicide that I can provide to you that show the relationship between mass shooters and SSRI drugs. The issue is the root, not the fruit. The guns are the fruit. I'm surprised that none of us have been doing research and nobody's even talked about getting to the root of the issue. Number two cause of violence, and 80% of the cases that I have of the SSRI stories are all users, as was the people I just mentioned, of what we call first-person shooter games. Why is no one suggesting that we regulate, put an age limit? Maybe you can only have 7 games. Maybe you can only have Warcraft, Killzone, or Bulletstorm, but not 4 others. Why is nobody suggesting that there be a test? I would suggest that those who take SSRI drugs might want to consider going through some background checks as far as are they with a therapist, or is the doctor just prescribing these them with no oversight? Research at the University of Indiana showed this, and I quote, "Behavioral studies have shown an increase in aggressive behavior after violent video games," says Dr. Matthews. "We're showing that these changes are in the brain function that relate to violent behavior. The video game players, meanwhile, showed similar brain activity in baseline tests, but after only a week of violent games, they revealed significantly less activation in their emotional brain centers. and they showed destructive sociopathic disorders. They had a loss of emotion, a loss of care for their fellow man. Now, I've dealt with kids. Our group counsels people who have been on SSRI drugs and first-person shooter games, and at times, some students have stayed up for 3 days straight playing first-person shooter games. Let me just finally end with a few more stories from my own.
Sir,
regarding
you're over 3 minute time. There's a line of people here. If you could just make your last cogent point.
Okay, I'll make a very last comment. In the last 6 months, in my neighborhood in Robbinsdale, Minnesota, there have been 5 burglaries, daytime smash-ins, all by 2 people. Regarding magazine capacity, I'd like to say this. I don't expect my wife to take down two men who break into her house with 7 or 10 rounds. I think it's important that we understand that many times, in my neighborhood anyway, people are facing not just one assailant, but 2. So I would like to just quickly speak to that issue of magazine capacity. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Welcome to the committee.
Thank you. My name is Doug Brown. I'm from Hutchinson, Minnesota. I'm a former Green Beret, served with the 10th Special Forces. I'm also owner of Ballistic Firearms Training Center of Minnesota. I'm certified as a firearms training organization of the Department of Safety. I'd like to bring up a point that was missed yesterday on HF 241, and that is on line 9.31. It says, whoever possesses a weapon only on property owned or immediately controlled by the person or while engaged in the legal use of a weapon at a duly licensed firing range or while transporting the weapon in compliance with the United States Code 18926A. I'd like to point out that there are no licensed gun ranges in the state of Minnesota that I'm aware of. So that would mean if that bill passed, the only place we could transport our guns is out of state, period. So I think that should be considered. So I just wanted to point that out. Let's see. Firearms and magazines are tools, nothing more than a tool. If a tool is restricted, the criminal will adjust to a new tool. I'd like to point out, case in point, 9/11. Case cutters were used to take over the planes, crash them into the World Trade Center. How many people died because of case cutters? The criminals adapted. In China, the same day of Sandy Hook, a person went into an elementary school with a knife and cut up 22 children and stabbed a teacher, cutting off ears, fingers. So people will adapt if there's restrictions on different types of weapons. They just adapt to a different type of weapon. In self-defense situations, the person being attacked is responding to an offensive attack. The person never knows if the initial attack is a single person or multiple assailants. A defender must react quickly and have sufficient ammunition to deal with a single or multiple attackers. Add to this the assailant, if he's on drugs, the situation is considerably more dangerous because the people who are high on drugs may not stop their attack after being shot, even several times. The adrenaline in an attacker's body combined with drugs keeps the attack going even when fatally shot. It's been documented that someone could be shot directly in the heart and still carry on the fight for 20 to 30 seconds. The issue of school shooters is a moot point. I don't mean to belittle that. It's very tragic what happened at the school shootings. But school shooters go into gun-free zones where no one shoots back. They have time to change magazines, pull out another gun, or begin stabbing people. They have what we call a tactical advantage in this gun-free zone. No guns and people who don't have skills to fight back. We teach our kids, our teachers teach our kids not to fight back. Our teachers are told not to fight back. So they just wait in order to get executed by the shooter. So why did police go to high-capacity magazines? Well, they had to adapt to what the criminals were using out in the field. Because criminals had high-capacity magazines, again, the law-abiding citizens are not the problem here. The statistics bear this out. It is the criminal element, that has no regard for the law. I have a reference below. I'll go over that in just a second. But one of the things I'd like to point out is that I live in rural Minnesota, and there was a landmark case called Warren versus District of Columbia, a case brought by 3 young women who had been held prisoner, repeatedly raped, and brutally assaulted for 14 hours by a home invader, while our earlier repeated calls to the police were ignored. They took it to court, and the court ruled, and their statement was, the government and its agents are under no obligation to provide police protection to any particular individual citizen. That edict on a precedent in a dozen similar cases, what was upheld in D.C. Court of Appeals, which ruled the duty to provide public services owned to the public at large, and in absence of a special relationship between the police and an individual, no specific legal duty exists.
Sir, you got to wrap it up. Okay. We're almost at 4 minutes.
I'm almost wrapped up. The courts, including the Supreme Court, have ruled the government has absolutely no duty to or responsibility to protect individuals from violent crimes. So the police response is going to be a post-action event. I just like to comment there was an encounter between two police officers and a burglary that resulted in a shooting between police. And in that particular instance, there were 10 shots. The female police officer was shot, but in the total shootout of the officers shooting the perpetrator, there were 10 shots. One to the wrist, two to the chest, one to the left side of the abdomen at zero range, the fifth one to the upper part of the abdomen, six to the top of the head, seven to the chest, eight to the chest, nine to the abdomen. The final shot was in the pelvis hip, and the perpetrator was reaching for his gun and trying to shoot, and they bled out and died. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. People, you really, I mean, really, it's, I mean, I know it's hard to get, but we really need to keep it to 3 minutes. There's a big line of people that want to speak, and you can always write your testimony, too, down and present it to the committee. Please introduce yourself. Welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. My name is Andrew Justin. Mr. Chair, members of the committee, citizens of Minnesota, everything that I wanted to say has been already said, so I will not waste your time. The one stories that I want to share with you that was a point that was brought out by Ms. Martens earlier that allowing citizens large capacity magazines or, you know, carrying several rounds would endanger those around you because of the fact that they might not hit. Well, I wanted to bring out two cases where that wasn't the case. In Tucson, where I forget his name, where he shot Gabriel Giffords, there were several people that had a permit to carry that day that brought down the shooter, and they were reluctant to fire because of the fact that they might harm other bystanders. And again, a more recent event in the Oregon Mall, there was a man, Nick Maley, I believe. He again gave a, he spoke to a news agency where they asked him why he did not shoot his legally owned permit to carry gun. And he said that he was afraid of any bystanders that might get hurt or hit by any bullets that he might have fired. That is all I have to say. Thank you for your time.
Thank you for your testimony. Next.
Mr. Speaker.
Welcome.
Committee members. My name is Sam Mead. I grew up on a cow-calf operation in Wyoming. I come from a long line of men and women that have served this country. My great-great-uncle served in France during World War I. My grandfather served in World War II, and another served in the skies over Korea. My great-grandfather served his country as governor and a senator in Washington, D.C. My parents are active members in our community. Perhaps it is because of this history that I hold my liberties in such deep regard. If HF 241 and 242 pass, however, myself and my grandfather would become criminals, not because we are out committing crimes, but because we own an inanimate object that is deemed unfit for free man's use. How can this seem reasonable? In your hearts, you must know that a restriction on magazine sizes and the types of weapons we are allowed to own will do very little to stop gun violence. I've heard from more than one person that say they will not comply with such laws. If law-abiding gun owners with a long history of responsible gun ownership are unwilling to obey such restrictions, how on earth can you expect criminals to follow the same? In 1995, Minneapolis became known to some as Murderapolis due to its high homicide rate. This was solved with youth programs, more aggressive law enforcement strategies, and aggressive crime prevention, not gun control. Spare us the fallacy that if it saves one life, we should do it. This logic is painfully ignorant. If we lived by such a mantra, no one would drive cars, fly in planes, or work on farms. This is America, land of the free and home of the brave. Freedom does have a cost, and it is often the lives of the innocent. That is why we must always work to defend it. Any type of gun control is a political appeal to the ignorant, and it always will be. I urge you instead to be brave and look at the root causes of violence. This is not a democracy, but a constitutional republic. You are elected to uphold the Constitution and stand fast against the wanton sway of public opinion. Mob rule is no rule at all. Hold the line. Thank you for your time.
Thank you for your testimony. Next.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. My name is David Ports. I am a senior at McAllister College and a resident of St. Paul. I'm not here at the behest of any group or particular organization. I don't believe I'm registered to any political parties at this time even. Most of this testimony has already been given, so I will skip parts of this in the interest of making this quick. But the horrific events in Newtown were unimaginable, and they still turn my stomach to think about. Regardless of our politics and our views on firearms, nobody wants to see this happen again. Nobody wants to see it happen here. We are all anti-violence, and we are all anti-massacre. And it is for this reason that I strongly urge this committee to oppose HF 242 and the related 241 and 243, if it's still on the table. I've been following these hearings pretty closely. I want to say I stand by all of the testimony in opposition to these bills. I think it is both ideologically sound and factually correct. I would like to talk first about the more neutral consequences of this bill and bills like it. I've been proud to call Minnesota home for the last 4 years, but I grew up in Northern California, and as you may know, California has had a similar package of bans on the books since before I was born. I am 22 years old, and to this day, these bans are an extreme source of bitterness, partisanship, and one-issue voters. They have had no demonstrable impact on public safety, and the only change they've really brought in recent years has been massive noncompliance and very, very clever ways of people getting around them and a disinterested response from the Department of Justice in pursuing these, I can't really call them loopholes in good conscience. The department itself devotes no resources to this. We all know this is a failed experiment and a waste. A unilateral statewide ban on magazines seems to me tailor-made for criminals. I'd like to remind this committee that a magazine is a box with a spring in it. It is, you know, can fit in your hand, can be easily hidden and trafficked. And if they're widely available, especially in the rest of the nation, there is no reason they can't be shipped clandestinely into this country by those who would wish to break the law. I have seen this happen firsthand in California, so it does happen. And the only people who will comply with these laws basically are those who will voluntarily do so. And you know, perhaps an unsuspecting enthusiast will be caught on his way to the range and made a felon, but a murderer, I doubt he will care whether his magazines are legal, as he's not supposed to have any magazines at all in the commission of a crime. Moreover, the worst act of violence, some of them against both police and the public in this country, have occurred during a 10-round magazine limit. Both the Columbine and North Hollywood shootings come to mind. And both of these acts of terror were committed by those prohibited from owning firearms.
Sir, can you wrap up your testimony, please?
Yes, sir. Notwithstanding all this testimony, the fact of the matter is that these bans are pure politics. High-capacity magazines or military-looking rifles have become the symbols of mass violence in the media and the public response, and legislation against them does make us feel good, but it has not worked, and any firearm in the hands of someone who is not supposed to have it can be extremely harmful.
Thank you for your testimony. Welcome. Introduce yourself for the record, please.
Julie Zappa, Gray Cloud Island Township. I'm speaking as a psychiatric nurse who works in the community with the mentally ill, both committed and not. Stop using mental illness to grow fear. Stop using the mentally ill as pawns in order to strip away the rights of all citizens. Speaking as a mother, stop using our love for children to grow fear. Stop using our children as pawns in order to strip away the rights of parents to protect their children. Speaking as a nurse who worked in Stillwater Prison, Could there be a more restricted environment? The offenders got drunk, did drugs, and yes, even killed one another. Restricting the rights of a law-abiding people won't stop the criminals. And I'm speaking as a U.S. citizen. You were elected to protect my rights and respect the Constitution. Don't let fear stop you from protecting the Second Amendment.
Thank you for your testimony. Welcome. Please introduce yourself for the record.
I'm Mary Lewis Groh, and Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, I represent the State League of Women Voters. The League of Women Voters is an organization that has members statewide, and we take a position based on a lengthy study and consensus that has come to by our members around the state. And our organization is in support of the bill that you are hearing tonight, and we support the bills you heard yesterday morning and on Monday morning. You've seen a lot of people over the last few days who represent the other side, and tonight, at least I don't have to worry that I'm repeating other people's testimony. But I would ask you to remember that although you see a lot of people in this room, and you saw a lot of people in this room yesterday and the day before, they don't represent the majority of voters in this state. And the polls have made that very clear. And derisive laughter doesn't make people right. But I believe the polls, and I know, and I will say, and I'm sort of departing from my point here, I come from a family of gun owners and hunters. They live on a different planet than the people we have heard from tonight and the other previous days. They believe that legitimate sports people do not need high-capacity magazines to hunt or for other legitimate purposes. And getting your jollies from target shooting, I don't think should weigh equally with the lives that are lost by high capacity magazines and high power weapons. I also would like to rebut the point that it is true that gun deaths are going down in this country. But as the Wall Street Journal pointed out in a well-researched front page article, gun deaths are going down partly because of the two wars we've been waging for the last 10 years, which have trained trauma physicians on the battlefield. They know how to save bodies that have been shredded by bullets. We have more trauma units available to more members of the population. But as the Wall Street Journal pointed out, so we have more trauma units, we have more surgeons who've been trained in saving the lives of gunshot victims. But the incidence of gun violence is up. I would like to say that you've heard a lot of arguments. We have 30,000 gun deaths in this country every year, and some of them are mass murders. Business as usual is not acceptable. We've tried keeping things the way they are. We've tried not changing our laws. It's not working. Please give us something else. Give law enforcement, give the public something else so that we know you're addressing the issues that worry most of us. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony.
My name is Charles Rumberger. I thank you all for your patience and hearing me this evening. I know it's been a long week and there's been a lot of testimony, but I also know that my experience represents a large portion of the population, particularly in rural areas. And I'm not a member of the NRA. I'm just a person who serves in a teaching monitoring capacity in a very small school in a rural area. I'd like to speak to House File 241. I was raised in what you might call a culture of responsibility. I remember hearing my father many times say that trust is something that's not given. Something that's earned. He expected us to earn it. And part of that culture had to do with learning to responsibly use a firearm. I spent about 9 years in 4-H, served as a club officer, a youth project leader. One of those projects that I was involved in as a member was shooting sports. In the course of that, when I was 12 years old, I started shooting .22 in 4-H. We spent countless hours on the range with qualified instructors who drilled into our head, action open, safety on whenever you leave the gun. and we would compete once a year. The gun that I used was from the 1960s, I believe. It was a semi-automatic gun. It didn't have a black stock. It wasn't folding, nothing special looking about it, just a plain gun that looked like it could have been used by Grandpa and had a shell which really could not be lethal to anything larger than a squirrel or a rabbit. But I would like to read for you from House File 241, just two lines, 3.4, 3.5, which talk about which kinds of guns would be classified as assault weapons. It says any semi-automatic pistol or any semi-automatic centerfire or rimfire rifle with a fixed magazine that has the capacity to accept more than 7 rounds of ammunition. This would classify the gun that I shot at 12 years old for years in 4-H as an assault weapon. In the process of dealing with this, I cannot see in this law that I would be accepted in going to get a permit for this weapon because it was, I got it from a brother who in turn got it from a friend. There's no paperwork surrounding it. And even at that, the cost of registering this seems fairly prohibited with every year having to renew it. So if I were to retain this weapon, which under this law I would not be able to do, I would be charged with, according to the penalty, could be charged with a felony, up to 5 years in prison, up to $25,000 for simply keeping the firearm, which I used as 12 years old in 4-H. I just wanted to point out that this legislation is very sweeping. It needs to be approached with caution. I also do know several hunters, at least, who do actually use an AR-15 as their primary weapon for deer hunting.
Sir, if you can wrap it up, it's 3 minutes, and we've got a whole line of people.
Okay.
I mean, it's just.
I do apologize.
Yeah.
I just wanted to remind you of what goes on here. That in rural communities, this is part of our way of life, and I'd like you to keep that in mind.
Thank you for your testimony.
I appreciate your
time. Thank you for your testimony.
Representative Neuberger, getting a little.
Thank you. I just wanted a quick point of clarification here for the committee to understand that the Wall Street Journal is not a medical journal. It is a news magazine, or it's a news outlet. And for the Wall Street Journal to become an authoritative source on trauma care, I think, is a stretch. Thank you.
Please introduce yourself for the record.
My name is Melissa Pierce, and I'm a resident of Anoka County. I grew up in southern Louisiana, and when I was about 12 years old, my neighbor was shot in his driveway, not 20 yards from my front door. And I can't help but wonder if having a weapon with enough bullets would have helped protect him in front of his wife and his family. One point I want to make that hasn't been made tonight regarding the legislation is the restriction of folding or telescoping stock. I'm a petite woman. A telescoping stock allows me to more comfortably hold a rifle. If my family's lives are threatened, I can use this to more accurately shoot my firearm and also reduce the chance that a bullet will stray out of the line of fire. This is only one of the features listed in the proposed legislation that allows a petite woman the ability to effectively level the playing field between herself and a violent aggressor. By taking this feature away, you're reducing my ability to protect myself and my family. And in closing, I personally choose not to carry a gun, but I am grateful for people who legally do carry weapons and are willing to risk their lives for me and my son. I would feel better knowing that someone is in my son's school, in the mall, or in the grocery store, has a weapon, has been appropriately trained and certified in its use, is responsible for its storage, and would be willing to put themselves in the line of fire for me and my son, and I want to give them the tools that they need to do so. Thank you for listening.
Thank you for your testimony. Welcome.
Good evening, members of the board. My name is Justin Pierce. You might notice that the young woman before me was also named Pierce. That's my wife. You also notice that she said she was grateful for people that protected her and her son. I'm a little bit disappointed that I wasn't included on that list, to be honest. So, as I begin here today, I would like to point out that I'm an engineer. I work for ATK. I am here on my own behalf. I am not here on the behalf of them, and I speak of my own opinions and not their opinions at all. As such, This, I've been following this debate over the last couple of days, and I've recognized that this is not so much a debate about facts, but a debate about emotion. And as such, I would like to point out, or I'd like to just comment on my emotions about the subject. I volunteered as a scoutmaster for approximately 8 years. During that time period, I was able to watch as young men grew into leaders. And as I helped them grow into leaders, I used firearms as a method of doing that. Teaching our children and our youth about firearms and about the safety, the discipline, and the respect that comes with that teaching does great strides for teaching them how to respect others, how to understand, and how to learn and grow in society today. I saw firearms change lives for the good. I saw young men become great leaders by using firearms as a tool. This is a subject that many people feel passionate about, myself included. We could go on about facts about how guns are play a role in other people's lives, and there have been many people that have done that already. When I married my wife almost 10 years ago, I promised her that I would preside and protect over our family, both spiritually and physically. Unfortunately, I'm not able to be home all the time because of my job. Fortunately, I do not fear that she has the capability to protect herself, because I've taught her how to use guns and I've taught her how to protect herself in our own home against any ill will that might come. I appreciate your consideration of these bills. I appreciate that you're here today. I appreciate the work that you do for us as your constituents. And I urge you to think carefully about how these bills affect your constituents and their Second Amendment rights. I do that very gratefully. Thank you very much.
Thank you for testimony. People, I'd really like to get done by 10 if we can, so I, you can write your testimony down too if you'd like.
Hello, my name is Nathan Miller. I'm from Coon Rapids, Minnesota. I would like to just read a definition of a specific word here. The use of violence and threats to intimidate or coerce, especially for political purposes. That's the definition of terrorism. What I believe is going on here, the reason we have the Second Amendment, why our founding fathers placed it there for us, was to protect us from tyranny. It wasn't for us to go hunting. It wasn't for us to go shoot ducks. It was to protect us from a tyrannical government. No one can protect my family better than myself, as long as I have my constitutional rights. Founding fathers set this up for a reason. I also noticed that the professor, when he was talking about the First Amendment, he named off the first four items on that list, but he forgot redress of grievances. That, for a lot of people that seem to skip over that one, has to do with us basically handing our current government a black spot of mutiny and saying that your job is done, we don't need you anymore. What I'm getting at here is that essentially we have the right and power to remove you and all others from office. If we continue down this path of seizure and destruction of our constitutional amendments, our rights that have been given to us by the blood of our forefathers, that this is quite possibly what will happen. I would just like to read one real quick, actually two real quick quotes from Thomas Jefferson. The strongest reason for the people to retain the right to keep and bear arms is as a last resort to protect themselves against tyranny in the government. And also, the beauty of the Second Amendment is that it will not be needed until they try to take it. I strongly advise and ask that every one of you says no to more registration, no to new gun laws, no to gun bans, no to ammo purchase limits, no to magazine bans, and no to any state and national registry. The difference between 10 rounds and 20 rounds, 30 rounds, when our government can fly drones over our heads and strike us from miles away, look through the walls. When the Second Amendment was written, our founding fathers were able to get that in there, and they told, or they showed us that we could have the same weapons that our military had at that time. I understand that's totally absurd right now.
Sir, you're over the way over the 3 minutes.
But if you take that into consideration, what difference is 30 rounds going to make in that case where you've got a government that's threatening our life and liberty? So I'm here on behalf of liberty, in my own opinion.
Okay, but thank you
for your time.
Thank you for your testimony. And folks, we are going to end at 10, so please try to make your comments real brief here.
Hello, my name is Dustin Helton, for the record. I live in Hastings, Minnesota, and I just have a few short things, and I apologize if some of these have been repeated, as I came straight from work and did not have as much time as I would have liked to prepare. I'm not going to talk about any statistics, as in college they taught me that almost anything can be written to achieve the desired results. Today I'm here to protect everyone's Second Amendment rights that are in this room. I would like to state that the bills being introduced here are intended to stop criminals from committing crimes. But you should all know that criminals do not follow the same laws and rules as society and law-abiding citizens. This is why they are labeled and called criminals. Ms. Martins earlier asked why anyone would need a 20 or 30 round magazine. Last year I went out to North Dakota and I went coyote hunting. And I had a 5-round magazine. And shortly after, I realized, after having multiple rounds in my pocket throughout the day, that some of those rounds had probably fallen out. And therefore it was much more convenient when a friend handed me a 20-round magazine. Therefore my rounds were safely and securely in one position and not falling all over the place. A few other things I'd like to say as well. There's many people who feel they do not feel safe within the state. Well, there is many other places as well to live if they do not feel they are safe here. Written laws don't work as deterrents. There are new criminals every single day. As a society, we can't determine or guess the acts of any one criminal, nor should we punish the rest of Americans and Minnesotans for any one person's crime or actions. Today, I saw a few people wearing against Minnesotans being shot, I believe. Well, I'm a gun advocate, and I'm against anyone being shot, unless it's in self-defense. I wish that many people would start focusing and enforcing the current laws we have and bringing the law-breaking criminals to justice. Getting these criminals off the streets will have greater impact, unlike the proposed gun laws. I apologize if some of the anti-gun activists and writers of these bills may be interested and sick of hearing these debates. But to all fairness, I sat here today and on Tuesday evening listening to both sides and their arguments. And to the woman who spoke minutes earlier, where are your supporters, as they have the same opportunity to speak over the last few days as we have. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony.
My name is Greg Dahlstrom, Lakeville, Minnesota. Thank you, committee, for hearing me today. I would also like to recognize the hundreds of people here in support of civil rights, both tonight and over the past few days. Mr. Chairman, I believe on Tuesday night you said a lot of people have a lot of problems with these bills, and that is why I've had a hard time deciding what to talk about tonight. In the end, I decided to apply the gun controls lobby mantra of Sandy Hook changed everything, and if these bills could only save one life. I decided that we should look at how these bills actually would have affected Sandy Hook. In Sandy Hook, the shooter did not purchase his weapons, so HF 184 would not have impeded him. The shooter did not purchase his weapons, so HF 237 would not have derailed his plans. The shooter was not a carry permit holder, so HF 238 would not have swayed him. Again, the shooter was not a carry permit holder, so HF 239 would not have changed his minds. Again, the shooter did not purchase his weapons, so HF 240 would not have deterred him. The shooter used a rifle that was fully registered under a similar scheme that is proposed here tonight in the state of Connecticut. so HF-241 would not have stopped him. The shooter used 30-round magazines, which, as Ms. Martins stated earlier, were trivial to reduce to 10 rounds. In that vein, they would be trivial to reduce to 30 rounds. So HF-242 would maybe have slowed the slaughter by a few seconds. The shooter murdered his mother, the law-abiding woman he stole his guns from. So HF-244 would not have obstructed him. The shooter did not wear body armor, so HF-308 would not have hindered him. None of these bills talked about over the past few days, either separately or as a whole, would have saved a single life in Sandy Hook. Instead of introducing legislation that would do some good, I'm appalled that the authors of these bills chose Sandy Hook as the cover to push their gun control agenda. But there are things that can be done. Look around this room and you'll see well-lit exit signs, sprinkler systems, smoke detectors, and alarms. If we put just a fraction of that effort into protecting our children and teachers, many lives could be saved. The common response to a school shooter situation is to lock the classroom doors and hide. Simply reinforcing these doors, windows, and walls of classrooms could actually have saved some lives in Sandy Hook. We don't need to turn our schools into prisons for them to be safer from shooters, just as we didn't need to turn this place or any school into a fire station to be safer from fire.
Sir, can you wrap up your comments? It's 3 minutes.
When it comes to civil rights, I urge all of you to not give an inch. Thank you.
Thank you. And folks, we are going to end at 10, so if you want to write your comments down, and we'd be happy to make the committee, give them to the committee. Please introduce yourself.
Hi, my name is Dan Passer. I live in Minneapolis, Minnesota. I've got a quote, an eyewitness account, and I'll end with a question. Okay, from the Federalist Papers, Federalist 51, Madison, quote, "It is of great importance in a republic not only to guard the society against the oppression of its rulers, but to guard one part of the society against the injustice of the other part." Now, about 2 years ago in December, I was in the vicinity of Nicollet and 5th Street by the light rail, or 4th, by the Excel Energy Building, where there were about 12 guys, maybe between 17 and 19 in that age range, all wearing green army color shirts over their clothing. They were just sitting along the line. It looked weird. It was about 8:30 at night on a Friday. I just cut across to the other side of the street. I didn't realize what was going to happen. One of the guys stood up and started shouting something innocuous like "now" or "okay" or something. All the other guys got up, surrounded the poor white victim who was, you know, just going out for the night in downtown Minneapolis, surrounded him in a double circle. Okay, the guys in the middle, God knows what they did to him. I don't know if he survived. Okay, the guys in the outer circle stood motionless around so that no one could see what was going on inside that inner circle. You could hear the guy screaming his guts out. When they finally opened the circle, the guy fell to the ground. When they started pummeling, kicking him, and beating him as hard as they could with their fists in their legs, kicking him. At that point, everybody was calling 911. You know, of course, there was no policeman around. And they just stripped him of everything he had at that point in time. And then they ran, as fast as they could, and they could all do the quarter mile in 10 seconds. So a 10-round gun is not going to be sufficient. All right, my question is, what percentage of law-abiding citizens who have their CC permit commit violent crimes? Thank you.
Thank you for testimony. Next.
Thanks for your time. My name is Sean Alter. I'm from West Bloomington. I have been a lifelong Democrat up until this last election. Judging from how this bill was written, I doubt my support will continue. I don't see how this bill is written is like everyone else said, is going to help prevent any type of violence whatsoever. I do work at a local gun range in the area. I have, in fact, sold guns to several people in this room right now. After they get their carry permit, which costs $100 in Minneapolis, and after they have gone through training, which, depending on which course you go to, costs at least $75 or $150 between them, they can now come to me and I can call in a federal background check. Sometimes they are delayed. In every case of the hundreds and hundreds of background checks I've done, they have all been preceded after I have called the federal background check. This bill is going to make one more piece of red tape get in the way of legal citizens owning firearms. As I said earlier, these are standard capacity. High capacity is a political term. Assault weapon is a political term. I am originally from New York State. I have lived here for the past 3.5 years. I don't see any of the bill whatsoever that is passed in New York as preventing any violence whatsoever. It will charge criminals, maybe make them more willing to invade homes. And just in my own personal experience, I've seen thousands of people come in the gun range. They're all a little bit nervous when they first go and shoot a gun for the first time. The cloud of ignorance of not being educated on an issue is the fear that you're seeing from some of these people that are for this bill. After those same people that had a little bit of fear and hesitancy leave, I see this. I see smiles every single time. I've seen this thousands of times. Thousands of times, people walking into the gun range a little nervous, trying something out, realizing that is an inanimate object, it's a tool. And it's probably no more or less dangerous than a chainsaw. We all have respect for those tools. This is no different. I see smiles leaving. I see concern going in. And with the political environment right now, I see a whole lot of people frowning, and they're all scared. I want some education on this issue. Thank you for listening to us. Thank each and every one of you for keeping an open mind. I hope that the cloud of ignorance does not affect you, and I hope that you could listen to us. Thank you.
Thank you for testimony. Next. Welcome.
Hello. My name is Roger Paris. I just wanted to state real quick, these proposals, especially Bill 241 and 242, don't appear to be common sense approaches to me. 242 will do nothing to prevent crime, and frankly, 241 will not either. According to Ms. Martins, when she was asked about how these magazines will be removed from the streets in relation to 242, basically the crime occurs, and then maybe they get the magazine off the street. With the millions that are out there, this is futile. Only law-abiding citizens will be impacted, because what criminal is going to take their magazine and alter it to have less rounds? Earlier I heard the gentleman from Protect Minnesota speak about pharmaceutical drugs, and he made some excellent points. That's something that I think a lot of these people can get behind and say that's the root of our problem, and that's where we should focus our attentions, not on the end result. What caused it? Let's look there. You know, I've been here all 3 days, and I've seen is, you know, just bill after bill that seems to be impacting law-abiding citizens. Why aren't we introducing 13 bills that increase penalties on gun crimes? That's something that we would support. That's common sense. But, you know, I just keep seeing these bills, and I can't say I'm happy with them at all. But thank you very much, and have a good day.
Thank you for your testimony. You know, we're not going to get to everybody that's on the line there, I'm afraid, but, you know, let's keep going until 10.
Michael,
welcome.
Thank you. Michael Fiato, Bloomington. This is basically addressed to Representative Slocum, who's not here, but I'll throw it on for the record, and the other members who have crafted this 241 and 242 and this other legislation targeting law-abiding citizens. You've betrayed an authoritarian mindset by crafting this contemptuous legislation, and have now publicly committed yourselves to advocating for the almost complete disarmament of your fellow law-abiding neighbors. What you have proposed makes me question very seriously whether or not you are now in violation of your oath to the U.S. Constitution, of which the Second Amendment is the most fundamental part. After all the talk about looking for common sense solutions that will respect the rights of law-abiding people, you come up with HF 241 and 242 and the others, legislatively harass and terrorize the very people who are not the problem, disarm them, threaten them with unconstitutional searches and jail time if they do not comply, and then turn around and have the audacity to say, we aren't taking your rights away? I guess so, a word of thanks is in order, as all DFL gun owners, too, now witness this outright betrayal. HF 241, as currently written, is not an assault weapons ban, as it obviously redefines that ridiculously overused and propagandized phrase to include virtually every gun owned today in Minnesota. This is a ban on nearly every semi-automatic weapon in existence and will mark the effective end of the Second Amendment in the state of Minnesota for the law-abiding, and very arguably the beginning of a criminal free-for-all for which you will all be held responsible if you vote for this. The idea of having agents of the state also come into homes inspecting the homes of law-abiding, as stated in 10.16.2, without due cause, is the quintessential calling card of authoritarianism. You may not think so, as many of you or some of you may not be gun owners, the ones who crafted this, but hundreds of thousands, 1 to 2 million of your Minnesota neighbors, both Republican and DFL, do, and now recognize you and the co-authors of this bill as vicious enemies of the Second Amendment. The people will not forget this shameful backsliding attack on their fundamental and constitutional right to keep and bear arms. And I'm just going to wrap it up with one story. I sat on a jury for a second-degree murder case here in Minnesota, here at downtown Minnesota, January last year. And it was a gang member who had murdered another gang member, second-degree murder trial. And I held out for him. I did the best I could. His lawyer represented him as eloquently as possible and tried to make it into self-defense. But the fact of the matter is, at the end, he was part of what amped it up, and I had to convict him. The irony of life, now, irony rules the world. You now want to put me in there with him. And I find it insulting and outrageous. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony.
Everybody still doing okay? My name is Riley Johnson. I'd like to start off this by thanking everybody for the civility and respect that we've seen from most of this hearing, and for bringing us to the table, stark contrast to what happened in New York. I'm a computer engineer. I'm the son of an FBI agent, former Detroit SWAT team member, and I speak for him in his civilian capacity. I've lived and worked in the Phillips neighborhood fighting against the poverty, crime, and violence there for the last 3 years. People have dealt drugs out of my apartment building. I get woken up by gunshots almost weekly, and people get shot in my alley. 911 is tired of hearing from me. I live there because I believe that when you care about someone, you put your body between them and the people who wish to hurt them, and you say no more. I want to say that my life has been affected by gun violence when my uncle was murdered in Illinois. But where I live, my family's experiences, and my race are irrelevant to the reasoned assessment of solutions to violence. You've heard firearms experts tell you that there are millions of hunting rifles are equally as deadly as the ones this ban would affect. They're trying to ban rifles on the basis they are black and look scary when there were only 3 murders with rifles in Minnesota in 2011. I'm not sure how to escape the conclusion that this is not a sincere attempt to prevent gun violence. I want to be constructive here. As of 2012, Minnesota ranks dead last in 4-year high school graduation rate in the nation for Latinos and Native Americans, second to last for blacks. The institutions that you preside over are failing the kids in my neighborhood. And we're here solving a rifle problem that doesn't exist. Let's have a conversation about how to brighten the futures of our young people. I love this particular gun ban bill because it is so extreme. It bans way more guns than the 1994 federal ban, which illustrates very clearly the step-by-step strategy that anti-gun lawmakers are taking to ban all guns. There will never be enough gun bans for them because gun control is not about guns. It's about control. There are people in the society we want to stop from getting weapons, but our government is made out of the same fallible people as our society. China, Russia, Germany, Rwanda, Serbia, Cambodia, these are real places where hundreds of millions of real people were slaughtered by their own government, people just as real as Aurora and Sandy Hook. The term for these deaths is democide, and according to Dr. R.J. Rummel, professor emeritus of political science at the University of Hawaii, the death toll in the 20th century, not including war, is 260 million people. So, and I want to say this respectfully, you're going to find very few people who are willing to comply with registration and magazine limits because these things lead to confiscation. By my admittedly rough estimate, there are about 170,000 Minnesota guns threatened in these bills. If you're going to have to open a whole lot of prisons for us.
Sir, can you wrap up your it's 3 minutes and there's still a line and we're closing at 10 and
I'd like to
give people an opportunity.
I ask you a rhetorical question. Ask yourselves, are you prepared to do that? And let me tell you, you don't want to see what society looks like without the brave and honest people behind me. I'm here to join the tens of millions of American fathers, mothers, FBI agents, cops, and military who will not be disarmed and who are saying to you on behalf of future generations, no more.
Thank you for your testimony.
My name is Eric Sorensen. I've been a resident of Minnesota for 38 years, and it is my basic human right to be able to defend myself, and this right is reaffirmed in our Second Amendment. And I oppose all of these bills that serve the purpose of preventing me from being able to do that. The FBI, CDC, and Justice Department studies have shown that the 1994 to 2004 assault weapons ban did not work and will not work in the future. As stated, the Columbine and Virginia Tech shooters used ban-compliant guns with 10-round magazines. Again, guns that were compliant with the assault weapons ban. If gun control actually worked, Washington, D.C. and Chicago would be the safest cities in the nation, but they are not. They have the toughest gun laws, but they have the highest gun crime rates. Canada has abandoned their long gun registry program because it was extremely costly and could not be shown to reduce gun crime. Great Britain's strict gun ban and mandatory gun registration has failed to stop mass killings and gun crime over the past 25 years. These guns and magazines proposed to be banned are currently legally owned for hunting, sport, collection, and personal defense. It would be a financial hardship for people to purchase new guns and smaller magazines. The Department of Homeland Security has stated that a rifle chambered in 5.56 NATO with a 30-round magazine is suitable for personal defense. That definition would include all these guns listed in the proposed ban. January 23, 2003, a New York man confronted two armed burglars that had broke into his residence. By using his AR-15 and 30-round magazine that he legally owned, he caused the burglars to flee and no shots were fired. The Second Amendment has been ruled to specifically extend to firearms in common use by the military for traditional lawful purposes such as self-defense by the Supreme Court in U.S. versus Miller. I feel school districts should have the right to decide if they want staff members armed and trained to guard their students. The school board in Sandy Hook has voted to place armed guards in all schools in their district. We already have laws in place to deal with criminals and gun crime in Minnesota. The proposed legislation will only trample on law-abiding citizens' rights and make it difficult to defend themselves. They will not reduce crime. Criminals don't obey laws, just like illegal drugs. Criminals will bring illegal guns, magazines into our country and states. Guns exist on a global level. We can never achieve a gun-free utopia with no gun crime. I have a longtime friend who has over 25 years in the North Minneapolis Police Department and has also been a SWAT team member for many years. And he's called the proposed legislation absolutely insane and will do nothing to stop gun violence. However, gun violence in Minneapolis has been reduced not with gun bans or magazine limits, but with law enforcement focusing on the social issues that cause young people to become violent criminals.
Sir, can you wrap up your testimony?
Absolutely, sir.
Thank you very much.
We need to put our resources into hiring the trained police officers that are able to catch these criminals and also enforce our laws to keep the criminals in prison. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony.
Mr. Chair.
Representative Cornish.
I would also ask, as the chair has, that you won't be able to come up and just go on as long as you want. The chair has been more than gracious in the time, and so if you can shorten it up to 1 minute, be respectful of the people behind you, it'd be great. And please don't complain if we have to quit at 10, because we all have to work again tomorrow, too. Well, thank you.
Hello, my name is Kerry Hogan. I live in St. Paul. I want to commend the committee on their stamina. I thought by now they would surely have sent out for pizza. I noticed when the president was in Minneapolis the other day, he mentioned that it was a wonderful city and is a good example. I don't know if you use the word gun control or not, but I'm curious if he knew how wonderful it was. Did he leave the Secret Service behind? I don't think he left them behind. I was also sort of upset not to see Representative Houseman here, as I had hoped to do my best Charlton Heston imitation and smile and say something about cold, dead hands. I'm also surprised to see how much Heather Martens resembles Dianne Feinstein. It's curious. Again, this law really will not deter criminals. If it would, I'd be all for it. If you could guarantee me that not one person, criminal, police officer, soldier, crook, anybody, would ever threaten me with a firearm, I'd say go for it. But I don't think that's going to happen. I appreciate and have been chatting with someone from the other side, and I'm impressed with their optimism, but I would think they would be better served by putting it on to something that might really come true, which is maybe a Vikings in the Super Bowl. I wouldn't recommend you passing this law, because I think I'm going to say right now that I will not shoot at the police, but I'm not going to obey this law. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your testimony.
Oh, I forgot. In nomine patri et filii et spiritus sanctu. Amen.
Thank you for testimony. Next.
Hi, my name is Catherine Hoffman. I live in St. Paul. I'm here to testify in favor of HR 242 and 241. I have a weird sense that I'm in the minority here. I don't know why, but like many folks, I became interested in this issue after the horrible tragedy in Newtown, Connecticut. This event left parents like me feeling incredibly vulnerable. I leave my children at school every day. Sorry. And I must trust my fellow citizens that they will be safe and sound when I return. There will be more shootings. More innocent children will die. I believe that any measure that limits the ability of a person to shoot many people, many children, in a few short minutes is a good idea. But I'm here not just as a parent, but also as a non-gun owner. As a non-gun owner, I represent the majority of Minnesotans and the vast majority of women. Many of the well-meaning folks that are here today believe that we cannot stop the flood of guns in our society, that regulation is futile, that criminals will always find guns, and we should simply throw up our hands and we should all carry guns to protect ourselves. I'm here to tell you that this is disrespectful of my rights, because the right to bear arms has a corollary right, the right not to bear arms. I should not have to carry a gun to keep myself safe, nor should those who cannot carry guns, such as children. As gun right proponents insist on more guns, more powerful weapons, the rest of us are increasingly made to be victims. It's time to rebalance those rights. Gun owners must accept some limitations so that the rest of us may exercise our own right to be safe to pursue our lives, liberty, and happiness as we see fit. We must find a way for all citizens, armed and unarmed, to feel safe in public. And I challenge this committee to seek out that goal. And I challenge you to do it in a way that respects my rights as much as the rights of the other citizens here today.
Thank you for your testimony. Welcome.
Hello, my name is Alex Rubash. I know a lot of this has been spoken about already, so I'll try to skim through some of my notes here. But the way I interpret most of these laws or proposed laws is not to use this phrase again, but knee-jerk reaction. You know, some of the statistics that we heard tonight were that, you know, around 50% of these mass shootings have been done by people that have some sort of mental health issue. So I guess I'm a little confused why we haven't heard any proposed changes to our mental health system or anything to address those issues. And, you know, I haven't heard any development programs to help our youth or you know, help those that are committing these crimes to avoid crime and to become prosperous on their own. So I guess I would propose that instead of blaming guns, blaming inanimate objects, that we try to get to the root cause of these problems. Maybe that's just the engineer in me talking, but I believe in going for the root cause rather than you know, messing around and trying to get around solving the actual problem, because sooner or later we're going to actually have to solve the real problem rather than make these failed attempts at it. So thank you for your time. I got a little bit of a drive home, so I need to get going.
Thank you. Thank you for your testimony.
Hello, my name is Gina Patton. I live in Denmark Township. I've never come to a meeting like this. Kind of scared. I'll try to be really fast. I'm just coming here on my own behalf, and I just have two things to say. One is, next time you feel the need to put together a hastily written, ill-advised, overreaching, rights-threatening legislation on the heels of an emotional national tragedy, please resist, because it's the worst time to for logical, coherent thought. The second thing that I want to say is that as a mother, when my kids were little, I was always concerned when I sent them to a friend's house for a pool party, you know, not knowing if there was a responsible adult in the house who could be a gun owner. But my concern wasn't because they might be irresponsible with the gun. It was because of the other killing machine in the house, which is the swimming pool. And swimming pools kill 100 times the number of children who are killed by guns. And so if it's about the children, I think it's a little bit odd to go for the something that's rarer than being struck by lightning, and that's a fact, as far as the shootings. But the last thing I'll say is that I thought that to illustrate my point of all the children who have drowned by this dangerous piece of equipment whose only need is to is for having fun, I thought that I might bring with me some of the faces, some photographs of the beautiful children who have died. But I decided that that would be exploitative, craven, manipulative, and political. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. Next, sir.
I'm Bob Radke, and the thing that I've noticed in this bill, people say that the government is not going to confiscate our firearms. This is a confiscation bill right here, the way it's written. Because if you sign this on the 13th or the 1st of September, I cannot sell my gun to anybody. It's got to go to the crap shop at the police department. If I keep this gun collection until I die, then my wife has got 120 days to take it down to the police station. I cannot give anything to my grandson. Now, I've had things written up here to go by, but I'm going to close with saying, over the past 50 years, the people have known me, they've heard me say that you can fight a good fight on the bar stool. And I say, but that's what happens when you get out on the street. And I think if you people sign this bill, you're going to have 2,500,000 people get their butt off the bar stool, and they're going to be out in the back alley, and you're not going to be happy with the results. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony.
My name's Alan Learness. I live in Lake Elmo. I've lived in the Twin Cities for about 55 years. Before that, I lived in northwestern Minnesota in a rural part of the state. I am absolutely appalled that a legislator would craft a bill that's as blatantly unconstitutional as this bill or these proposed bills are, and then not even have the courtesy to be here to be questioned and hear firsthand the comments of people like myself who are opposed to unconstitutional grabbing of our firearms and denial of our Second Amendment rights. This is a bill that, if adopted, would confiscate firearms without just compensation, as somebody mentioned earlier. It also would deny normal law-abiding citizens the firearms protections that are in use all over the world in militaries and police forces and in other civilized lawful uses. This bill would provide for more onerous penalties for semi-automatic weapons than for fully automatic weapons under the U.S. laws. So I would urge you to be careful and consider these bills. Listen to the constituents that have showed up. This is just a preview of what you're going to see if this kind of bill gets any legs and gets further down. These people are not going to stand idly by and have our rights taken away from us. So please consider that comment, and that's a statement of fact, not a threat.
Thank you for your testimony.
My name is Frank Bifolk. I live in White Bear Lake. I'm a Vietnam veteran. My youngest son is a Bosnian veteran. My youngest daughter is an Iraqi and an Afghanistani veteran. I don't have hunting rifles. I have military-style rifles that I use for hunting. Everything I purchase is as a militiaman, the same militiaman that fought the American Revolution and were mentioned in the Second Amendment. I do a lot of things. I have a lot of hobbies, and the firearm interest is kind of a latent thing, and I started acquiring them not too many years ago. I bought two ARs, one for each of my daughter and my son, because I found out after Iraq, when Jessica Lynch made a wrong turn with her motor company, everybody got killed except her. And she was a rear echelon soldier. And rear echelon soldiers don't get trained very well because the Army can't afford it. They're not mainline troops. They're not mainline infantry troops. My son was in artillery. My daughter was in a psychological operation unit. But in every case, they were both in a real war situation. So I spent my money and bought ammunition and found people here in the United States in our area that could properly train them into the higher levels of readiness and reliability and ability to do the job if they make a wrong turn. And there actually is Greg Sullivan, who has his own teaching school, but he's also a SWAT commander for Anoka County. I have several magazines for each one of the rifles that I bought for myself and my children. They stay where they're at, and I'm just waiting. Because I believe that we as militiamen, we're all in the militia, whether you like guns or not, is that, We've got a lot of people have been pouring over the borders, north and south, mostly in the south. Nobody's doing anything to plug it in. We've been told we can expect, you know, dirty bombs and all sorts of things. And we already know that the China and North Korea are rattling their swords, and they're big enough to come on over here. And China is, because they've got 100 million men under arms. And the day may come, I hope it doesn't, they may come when they're coming to breach our borders. They're going to come into this country and they're going to start taking things because we've got a lot of nice things here to take. And I don't intend to let them have it, and I don't intend to reduce my capability as my membership in the general militia, and I don't intend to let anybody stop me from stopping enemies, foreign or domestic.
Thank you for your testimony. We're just going to take a couple more people, and then we're going to call it for a night. You can write your testimony, and I assure you every member of the committee will get your testimony.
Mr. Chairman.
Welcome.
And members of the fellow members of the committee. My name is Larry Hoyland. My wife and I reside in Plainview, Minnesota. I'll just go briefly on a few of these things. I know we're getting short of time. My biggest points are regarding things to consider on the background check. After attending both meetings Wednesday and Thursday and listening to the discussions on 237-240, I've come up with a different perspective I'd like to have you consider. The 60s were a time of rampant lifestyle, sex, drugs, live free, if it feels good, do it. A very unpopular Vietnam War and anti-war protests were very negative in attitudes anyone with authority. Following this period, we got to the point of lack of respect to family values. Divorce was very easy to come by, and anyone that wanted it. Lifestyle of free and not accepting responsibility of being a parent, leaving one parent to care for child or children, and depriving many children of a sound, stable home life. Next came the government involvement in public schools. Zero discipline. School staff were not allowed to discipline children. Misbehaved school. Next came child protection laws, which had young children coming home telling parents they couldn't spank or they could return to school, tell school authorities, and they'd contact authorities. This zero tolerance and lack of family values, plus violent video games and abortion, has resulted in a generation of young people that are very desensitized to human values of life. Most of these people could more than likely pass a medical exam. A lot of them people know how to manipulate system, telling that they think the professionals want to hear. The children involved in gang activity are looking for a place to belong and are looking for acceptance from anyone that will give it to them. No matter how negative it is, it may lead to a life of crime, violence, drug dealing, killings, and physical. It may also include physical abuse, family members, or close friends. We live in a society where people are resentful of what others have, they don't have, and respect for anyone of authority. These shooters in both the Gore and Newtown shootings were lacking in acceptance and were loners. We cannot legislate every and anticipate what someone might do. The news media also should shoulder some of the blame because 24/7 news cycles, mass shootings, are constantly on the rise. Possibly there's all someone out there thinking if they did something bigger, the attention they get, and no one wants to limit free speech, but how much detail do we need days after? I feel more sensation. I feel the more we sensitize this possibility, emboldening the next person to commit an act of violence, something bigger, more damage. I ask you to consider these things when you look at the mental and psychological evaluation. I don't believe gang members are all totally mentally incompetent, but they've been deprived by things that we've brought on to them. I will skip over a lot of the other things we've said here about the gun laws, and it's pretty much repetitive. So in closing, I'm going to cut it off very short here. Look at the Chicago city's strictest gun laws and books, and yet they have the highest murder rate in the country. May I add, the man involved in the Aurora, Colorado shootings has scoped out 3 movie theaters, 2 of which allowed conceal and carry. He chose the one not to allow guns.
Sir, you've got way over the time.
In closing, I would like to leave you with a thought to consider. That every nation that has lost their right to bear arms has lost their freedom. The biggest lie ever told to a nation, and I quote, "Turn in your guns, your country will protect you." Adolf Hitler, 1935.
Sir,
thank you for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you very much. I'm going to give this woman the last word, and then Representative Lohmer wanted to make a comment, and then we're going to adjourn for the evening.
And also, I would like to say, Mr. Chairman, if I could, I've got copies if you would care to take them.
Very well. If you give them to the page, we'll make sure everybody gets them.
Thank you.
And I really, as she comes up, I just want to thank everyone for your respectful and civil behavior and discussion here tonight, and we're going to take everything and everything you've said into consideration as we craft a bill. Ma'am, please introduce yourself for the record.
My name is Donna Golden from Nelda, Minnesota. Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm going to make this real short. This whole thing condensed, too. There is no common sense in infringing upon or denying citizens their constitutional rights to defend themselves. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Representative Lohmer.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just want to thank all of the people who came to testify over the last 3 days. I'm just amazed and really appreciative of the willingness for people to come from so far away and to be here all day for 3 days. I know a lot of you have been. And I really, really wish that we could hear from everyone, because it's just wonderful that you're here. It is your right to be here. This is the people's house, and you are taking advantage of that, and you are using that right to share. So whichever side you are on, I want to commend you for that and thank you for that. And then I also want to echo the gentleman's concerns from Lake Elmo that the author of this bill and yesterday morning's bill was not here. I just feel that's a really large concern. These people were here to address the concerns in her bill. And as legislators, I'm just in my second term, but we have to be kind of quick on our feet, and we have to change our schedules a lot. I have to do that tomorrow because I'm going to be with the governor. I have to change something else. And I think that just with all these people that were here, that she should have been here to hear her testimony. And I know, Mr. Chair, that anyway, that you moved the bill and all, but I just really think it's a disappointment. So thank you, Mr. Chair.
Any other members? The chair will lay over House File 242. Thank you all for coming. Meeting's adjourned.
Thank you all for coming.